this?
Hester. And who is this?
Maria.
And who are we together? The Concert Counselors! A few weeks ago, in episode 34, we presented a quiz to celebrate that we reached 1,000 subscribers on YouTube.
And whether you send us an email to participate on the quiz or not, you may be curious to know what the right answers were to our 3 questions.
Therefore, today we will reveal all the answers to these 3 questions, and as cherry on the cake, we will present some more exercises based on those topics.
Those can go on your repertoire of short warm-up exercises before a rehearsal.
The first question was,
how many extra notes did Silvestro Ganassi discover in the high register of the alto recorder?
In episode 24, we referred to Ganassi's own words. In his instruction book, he claims to have discovered 7 extra notes. And this was the answer we were looking for.
However, there is a second possible answer to this question, because although Ganassi writes about 7 extra notes, he considers the chromatic versions of the same pitch as being one note. So when you count F and F sharp, G and G sharp, B and B flat, C and C sharp, and D sharp as different notes, then you get to a total of 12 extra notes. We have also accepted this answer, although it's a little bit different way of thinking than in Ganassi's writing.
Have you ever stopped to think that there may be a special reason why Ganassi mentioned 7 notes and not 8 or 6 extra notes? In his recent article, Pedro Silva suggests that the motivation to have 7 extra notes has everything to do with the recorder being the perfect instrument in connection to the music theory of that time. Because an octave and a sixth is 13 notes, and 13 plus 7 is 20 notes. And these 20 notes seem to be a magic number. With these 20 notes, you could move through the whole theoretical range of the music system of that time, the gamut.
Here follows an exercise that has actually nothing to do with Ganassi himself, but it does have something to do with high notes and with remembering and practicing new fingerings in the high register. And we combine that with practicing our daily scales. And therefore, this exercise is called octascales, because we practice octaves and scales.
To start this exercise, we pick one note that we want to practice in the high register. For example, the high A flat. Let's practice 2 different patterns with the middle A flat and the high A flat. And let's do that all together.
Since we picked the note A flat to practice, let's now practice the A flat major scale. For this, we start on the lowest possible A flat on our instrument and we play half speed in relation to the previous exercise. We go up 1 octave and then we come down 1 octave.
And now, let's divide the group in half. One half is going to play the pattern, and the other half is going to play the scale.
Once this is working, we swap roles. I play the scales, Hest plays the pattern.
Needless to say, you can think of all kinds of variations on this exercise. For example, pick a different tonality or swap continuously your role. Start with a pattern and then play the scale and then the pattern and then the scale, and the other half of the group is going to do the exact reverse. Good luck!
The second question in our quiz was...
According to the concert counselors, what are the three possible purposes of an alternative fingering?
In episode 9, we mentioned that alternative fingerings can be very useful to produce a louder version of a certain pitch. Or a softer version of a certain pitch. Or to produce a completely different color without changing the pitch.
We also mentioned that alternative fingerings can be helpful for the balance in an ensemble and to give a special touch to the ending of a piece.
So here is a little group warm-up with alternative fingerings.
Player 1 invents a melody of 3 notes involving the left hand area, so playing from the C until the G.
Player 2 takes this melody over and repeats it, but using only strong alternative fingerings. If you are not sure how to look for an alternative fingering, check episode 9 and we give you some instructions there.
Then, player 1 repeats their own melody once more, but now using soft alternative fingerings. And again, if you don't know how to make those, check episode 9.
After these 3 steps, player 2 becomes player 1, and we go through the whole game once more.
If you have more than 2 players in your ensemble, you can make a chain through the ensemble, like this. Invent a melody, louder alternative fingerings, softer alternative fingerings. Invent a melody, louder alternative fingerings, softer alternative fingerings. Invent a melody.
And when it's not your turn, you can still silently practice and check if you do know all the required alternative fingerings for your friend's little melodies.
And here comes the last question of our little quiz.
In one of our early episodes, we spoke about 4 body parts that have a major influence in the position of the tongue and also in the way in which the air flows into the recorder. Which 4 body parts are these?
In episode 5, we clearly named the following body parts: the throat, the jaw, the cheeks, and your lips.
The position of the jaw is especially influential in the position of the tongue inside the mouth. By lowering the jaw, we create a lot of space, a big mouth cavity, and the movements of the tongue need to become really big, and that's on the way of the airstream.
In general, the more relaxed our sound unit is, the warmer the airflow. By applying a bit of tension, we can create a cold and thin airstream.
Although in general we recommend cold air in recorder playing, warm air is also useful for us. For example, when we want to play with a full sound in the low register. Slow air will be helpful for this.
Let's play the following pattern with warm air. We achieve this by relaxing our cheeks, lips, and throat. However, let's not drop the jaw too much. Let's not use any articulation. Just some short gusts of warm air.
Now we are all going to take turns to improvise on this James Bond ostinato. James Bond is obviously a really cool guy, and therefore for his solo he uses cool air. But not only that, he also is so cool that he can improvise a whole solo on just one note, and that note is the middle F.
Your solo will have the length of one breath. So make your note as long as possible, and when you stop your solo note, you join the pattern again. Think of an U embouchure and feel the low temperature of your airstream flowing into your instrument.
Second goal is to make your solo as varied, as fun, as inventive as possible without using more notes than just the F. How can you do that? Repeat notes, add ornamentation, use finger vibrato, regular vibrato, any coloring you want, rhythms, flattertunge, effects, air, anything is allowed. Some of the exercises in this episode and the previous episode involved improvisation, and therefore our 30 seconds tip of today are to record the players who are also excellent improvisers, each of them in their own style.
The first one is Tali Rubinstein, a recorder player, composer, vocalist from Israel, and she brings all her recorder talent to the world of jazz and world music. She is a great, inventive and fascinating artist who has a mission, namely to jazz up the recorder. Watch this video on how she does that. How can you achieve what you want, copy from others and then make it your own. Tali, for example, learned all the Charlie Parker solos by heart and then she invents her own material. Very cool.
Another great improviser who is also a recorder player, but not only that, also a singer and a harpsichord player, is Martin Erhardt from Germany. He is an improvising performer together with his ensembles, among them All'Improvviso, which you can see in this video. But he is also an improvisation teacher and he has published Upon a Ground, which is a method to learn improvisation based on 16th to 18th century ground basses and ostinatos. If you have never improvised before, this is certainly your path to a new life and to new corners in your music practice. Check it out!
See you next week!
Bye bye!